Why don't y'all stand up with us and put our hands together? Yeah. Hallelujah.
Praise. He's worthy of our praise.
We want to welcome you to what we call the family room in our Westmore campus. We're delighted you're here. I'm Pastor Kelvin Page, and we are so delighted that you have come, and we're excited you've come to be a part of this conference. And we're believing the Lord is going to meet with us. We want this to be more than just a display of talent. We need the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And I don't know about you, we've been experiencing a hunger in our church. Pastor Cymbala and I were talking just briefly about that earlier. We're believing that the Lord is going to honor that hunger. And I believe he's going to visit us in the way that he desires to visit with us tonight. And so we welcome his presence while we welcome you. Let us pray. Father, we're thankful that you've brought us together for these few days. We believe that this meeting has been ordained by you. We come with expectancy. We come with hunger. We believe that you're going to help us to be contagious in our worship. We believe that your presence is going to fill us. And we're, Lord, believing that you're going to help us to make a world impact together. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. God bless you.
Sing with me.
Just to bow down before your throne, to see your face, I'll cry out, because you're holy, holy, holy are you, Lord.
Oh, you know it, sing it.
Jesus.
Holy, holy,
holy.
somebody join heaven and say that. Come on.
Worthy, 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 Lord.
Another glimpse of glory.
Oh, we'll sing once more.
Worthy,
worthy.
You are worthy, Jesus.
Forever.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Worthy,
worthy.
Hallelujah.
Another glimpse. I want to see you, Jesus.
Lamb of God, we thank you for your presence in this room. We thank you, Father, for being with us tonight as we've gathered to worship you. As we've gathered to worship you, isn't it wonderful that we can gather together from all around the world and join our voices and sing to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? He's coming soon. I said he's coming soon. And our hearts, I don't know about you, but my heart is ready. I'm open, and I'm ready for his return. Amen and amen. You may be seated. We're going to continue to worship in the presence of the Lord, but we are so honored, of course, that the Lord is with us tonight and in this very room and in this place. But I want to say thank you. Thank you. My name is Steve Allen, and this is my beautiful wife right here. Laura, would you please stand? Let everybody see my wife here. We've been blessed music pastors here at Westmore for 22 years, and God has been so good to us. And we have been privileged and honored to lead these beautiful, wonderful people in worship. And we love our Westmore family. And we love each and every one of you, and thank you for being with us tonight. There's a couple of people I want to honor and thank them for being here, and some people that have meant a lot in my life. And one of them is Delton and Myrna Alford. Would you please stand? They are the founders of Spirit Sound Music Group. And we are thankful for their ministry and what they have done for the Church of God and our music. Thank you. And then also Dusty's here tonight, and he is now the director of the Church of God Spirit Sound Group. Dusty, where are you? There he is. Stand up, Dusty. We're glad to have you tonight, too. Thank you. He's one of our big sponsors tonight. Thank you. We are also honored tonight to have our second assistant of the Church of God who is with us tonight, Pastor Tony Stewart, all the way from Tampa, Florida. Would you please stand, Tony? We're glad you're with us tonight. Yes, thank you. And then also, Dr. Mike Baker, president of the seminary. Would you please stand? So honored to have you tonight. Thank you. And we have many, many other guests. Thank you for coming to the conference. Thank you for being a part of this. And thank you for the community that's come out to be a part of this as we celebrate tonight. But we all know why we're here. You know why you're here. I know why I'm here, because I want to hear from the man of God, and I want to hear from some powerful singers from Brooklyn. And I want to share with you, in 2019, 40 of us from the Westmore Sanctuary Choir, we were able to go to New York and be a part of their last music conference they had right before the pandemic. And let me tell you something, it made an impact on our ministry, our music ministry. You could definitely see a change and a difference in our worship and our praise because of us just going and being a part of what they're doing. And we want to say thank you to Pastor Jim and Carol and the Brooklyn Tab Choir for what their ministry is and what it has done and impacted all of us. And I know, like you and me, we're very thankful. We also have tonight with us TaRanda Greene. She's with us.
Hey, Alvin Slaughter. Yeah. Somebody give God the glory, right? Oh, yeah. I told you need to pull that one out tonight. And you know what I found out tonight? Reba Rambo is in the house tonight. Wow. So glad to have you. Thank you for being with us tonight. Yes. And many others are with us, and we're so thankful. But most of all, we're thankful you're here, the Lord's here, and Pastor Jim Cymbala is going to come at this time, and he's going to share with us and introduce the singers. But would you please make them welcome as he comes? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you. You may be seated. We're so happy you're here tonight. We're happy to be here. We're from Brooklyn. This fresh air is going to kill us down here in East Tennessee. I don't know what we're going to do. So I want to just give a little explanation because I'm not supposed to be here by myself, and who's supposed to be speaking and greeting you is my wife, Carol. So what happened was, 3 weeks ago Tuesday, this past Tuesday, she had sprained her leg, and she was in downtown Brooklyn. We live a block from the church in downtown. We rent an apartment there, and it's 277 steps from our apartment to the church. I love that commute every single day. Don't have to go on a highway. So she ran to make a light, and pop. And we didn't know what it was, but she called me crying, and we had to go get a car there and then a wheelchair to get her up into the apartment. So she had an x-ray, and then 2 days ago she had, or yesterday she had MRI, and she's all, her leg, she tore her meniscus, but in a real bad way, so she couldn't be there. And it happened on the day right before the singers and her and I were supposed to go down to the National Prayer Breakfast where the singers sang, and I was one of the speakers, and she was supposed to direct. so she couldn't go, but her music went, and you're going to be hearing songs that she wrote and arranged, and other writers too. So these people behind me are they make up the Brooklyn Tabernacle Singers, and they travel and they sing on Sundays in our church. And to get here on this trip, they took off time from work. They took off vacation days, some of them. They really made some sacrifices. Can we thank God they could be here? So, we're just honored that we would be invited to be a part of this. I've never been to Cleveland, Tennessee before. And so we're not here to entertain you. We detest the idea of Christian entertainment. Jesus, wait, time out. Jesus did not die on a cross so we would entertain each other. He died on a cross so we could worship him and praise him. So put your hands together. Let's welcome the Brooklyn Tabernacle Singers.
Let everything Good evening, everyone. So we'd just like to say thank you so much for having us here on behalf of the Brooklyn Tabernacle and all these beautiful people behind me. You know, we come from all different backgrounds and some of us even different countries, different states, different cities. But the one thing that connects all of us is that we've all been transformed by the blood of Jesus. And so, as Pastor Cymbala mentioned, you know, we're not here to entertain. We're here to lift up the name of Jesus, and we're here to worship. And so we invite you just to sing with us, to sing to the Lord, and just to invite his presence into your life. This next song we're going to sing is called I'd Rather Have Jesus. And it just talks about just how amazing Jesus is, that we would rather have him in our life than any silver, any gold, any material possession that we could have. And so we just invite you to sing along, if you can catch the melody and the lyrics of the song, to worship with us. Amen.
Thank you. salvation unto you. You reign on the throne, for you are God and God alone. Because of you my cloudy days are gone. I can sing to you this song. I just want to say that I love you more than anything.
said he'd never leave me. Every battle he would fight. He's given me the victory. That's why I give him praise. I know he's working for my good. Yeah.
Oh my.
I'll praise him. Can't figure it out. Oh my.
Thank you. How about it for Brother Alvin Slaughter tonight? You may be seated. It is such a joy to be with you here in Cleveland, Tennessee. We are delighted to be with you. Thank you for the invitation. How about the choir and orchestra from earlier, the opening? Aren't they amazing? And Westmore Choir is going to join us on this next song. So you guys, are you ready? Wait, are you ready, choir? Okay, no one answered me. This is Church of God and no one responded. I was nervous. Oh man, God is so good. He's so faithful. He's so true. He's so divine. He's so wonderful. For those of you who may not know me, my name's TaRanda. And in 2010, my husband passed away. And we had a kidney transplant. I gave him a kidney. And a year later, his lungs started weakening and he developed a lung infection and couldn't fight the lung infection. The Lord took him home to be with him. And I thought that would be the hardest day of my life, but it turns out it wasn't. It was probably a year after he passed, and I still wasn't getting better. I wasn't moving forward. I was still having trouble raising my kids and having trouble figuring out what my new reality was. My parents live over in Knoxville, which isn't far from here. I know you know where Knoxville is. So I moved from Charlotte, North Carolina to Knoxville, Tennessee, and with my mom and dad. And mom helped me take care of my kids and made sure they got to school and made sure we all ate. And after several months of living with my parents, I wasn't getting any better. And mom said, maybe we should go to the doctor and see if there's something they can help you with or whatever. So we went to the doctor, and through a series of testings, they diagnosed me OCD, psychotic, which does not mean psycho, probably. Severely depressed. The doctor put me on 4 medications that day, and I took those medications religiously. The problem was, when I took those medications, I felt nothing. When I didn't take the medications, I felt everything. So taking these medications, they're just maybe so numb, and I couldn't feel what was around me or what was going on. And that's a problem because I was raised Pentecostal, and we feel everything. Even when there's nothing to feel, like, you know. So not being able to feel was a real problem. I lived like this for a little while, and finally, after making some terrible decisions myself, I looked in the mirror one day, and we were gonna go shopping for shoes. As I was getting ready, I looked in the mirror, and the person that I saw staring back at me, I did not even recognize. Through decisions I had made and through things that had happened to me, I didn't know who I was anymore. I did not recognize that face looking back at me. I couldn't find. I don't even know what it was I couldn't find, but it wasn't there. I started praying and I said, God, I know I'm not being who you created me to be. I know I'm not living like I'm supposed to live, but God, I don't know how to do this. I don't know how to be a single parent. I don't know how to make a living for my family. I don't know how to wake up and my best friend not be beside me. I don't know what I'm doing, Lord. And Jamal, I remembered this song that my mom taught me when I was a kid. And it says, great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not. They fell not. And as because I remembered that line and I sang that line. I remembered that what I was going through was not some punishment for what I had or hadn't done, but that God loved me right where I was. He saw me right where I was, and He was still there the whole time. And I said, God, forgive me for where I failed You. Forgive me for where I failed my family. If You will help me, I want to walk and be who You created me to be. I want to do and live like You would have me live. And the next day, after buying some fabulous shoes, Pastor, thank You, Jesus, I woke up and took my kids to school. And then the next day, I made them lunch, and they didn't die, and that was really cool. And every day since that day has been a step and another step and another step. And here I get to tell you tonight that after all these years, I'm completely depression medication free. And God has given me the opportunity to tell you that He is right for everything wrong in your life. He sees you right where you are. He knows you better than anybody. And He's just waiting for you to run home to Him. And that's not because of our faithfulness. It's because of His. So tonight, if you're dealing with something that you don't know what the answer is, and maybe after this conference you're going to go home and have to face it, God is faithful. Maybe tomorrow you're going to have to look at your kids in a decision that you're going to have to make. God is faithful. He will not leave you. He will never forsake you. He'll stick closer than even your brother. And I'm so thankful that I get to stand here and tell you that. And tell you that there is a restoration in Jesus.
In my moments of fear, through every pain and every tear, still
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Wow. How many would say that the Lord has been faithful to you? Yeah. Thank you, TaRanda, for your vulnerability. It's not often we get to hear people be that honest. But she's been honest with us, and to hear her sing that song with passion. I trust that if you're here tonight and you've been dealing with a heavy load, the same God that touched TaRanda is the same God that can touch you and I tonight. I believe that with all of my heart, don't you? Can we celebrate our Lord's presence? Amen. Amen. We've been talking about having a conference like this for a few years. In fact, Steve and the choir went up to Brooklyn, as has been mentioned before, and they came back, and I'll never forget them coming back and just sharing what God had done and what God had spoke to them. And I remember us talking back then, if we can ever get the Brooklyn Tab singers or whatever we can get, we'd love to have them down and do a music conference. COVID hit and all of that got delayed. And as time has went on, we decided we could do this, and we thought we would attach a ministry conference to it. And I really believe the Lord wants to do something. I believe that He wants to touch you tonight. As Pastor said earlier, it's not about entertaining you. I believe worship can be contagious. I believe the Holy Spirit moves on us and moves on one another, and He uses our worship. I also believe that He wants us to take ministry serious. And this week we want to peel back layers, Westmore and other ministries, and just talk about what the Lord has done and what He can do and through all of us as we look at our ministries, evaluate our ministries. And so there's some way along the way you'll be able to plug in, and many of you have registered for this conference. But I will tell you, it does take money to run a conference like this. We've done our best to keep the cost as low as we possibly could. And I appreciate Steve Allen and our ministry team. Could you let them know you appreciate them for putting on what they've done? Thank you. Appreciate it so much. So tonight, if the Lord could cause you to hear the need, and we're just believing the Lord is going to provide for this conference. We don't know all the hows, but we believe He will. He never lets us down, and He's faithful. And so could we just continue our worship and give unto the Lord and give unto Him? Because I believe that our blessings reside in Him. So, Lord, we thank You for this gathering tonight. You know who's here and who's not. You know who will be here the next few days as we talk about Your work and how to impact our communities and world. And we pray that You would sustain us and help us and meet the need in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.
Good evening, church. My name is Kim, and I'm so thankful that we are able to be here with you guys to worship. Well, I want to share a little bit of an encouragement with you all. How many of you all have heard the story of Peter walking on the water? I'm sure everybody, right? So Alvin actually mentioned something about this last night in our meeting in Knoxville, and it reminded me, Alvin, of what the Lord showed me 2 weeks ago. So I'm reading Matthew chapter 14, and you guys know the story, keeping in mind where Jesus just fed the 5,000 with his disciples. And at this point, I would think disciples are filled with faith. They're so stirred in their faith. They've just watched Jesus do this amazing miracle. And now Jesus says, all right, get in this ship. I'm going to meet you on the other side. I'm going to go up in the mountain to pray. So he goes and prays, and the people get in the boat, the disciples get in the boat, they're getting in the boat, they're heading to the other side, and now they're in a big storm. And the way the Bible has it written there, this had to be some type of crazy storm. I mean, something abnormal. And I don't know, maybe there's a storm that you guys are going through right now in your time, in your life, that is something you've never been in before. It seemed like this was that situation for these disciples. But you guys know the story. So they're in the boat, there's this storm, they see this figure out in the water that seems to be a spirit or a ghost, and it's Jesus walking to them, but they didn't recognize that. Then Jesus says, calm down, you know, peace be still. But then Peter, he gets bold, and he decides, I'm going to tell Jesus, hey, if it's you, call me out. So Peter walks out. He's walking on the water. And you see the miracle. He's walking, but then he gets distracted. He loses focus. He sinks, and then Jesus saves him. And voila, there's the story. So if you asked me previously, what are your key points from this story? What did you get from that? I would have said, okay, well, maybe if Peter would have kept his eyes on the Lord, he wouldn't have sunk. That's my first thought. Or it would have been like, wow, Jesus saves as soon as you call in his name. He reaches for your hand and he saves you, and he's automatically rescued you. But then, Matthew 14, verse 34, that verse stunned me 2 weeks ago. It said, and when they got back to the ship, the wind ceased. And I thought, wait a minute. So you mean to tell me Peter was still in a storm while he's walking back to the boat while holding Jesus' hand? He's still hoping and praying and trusting that I hope I get to safety, but he's still in a storm. And that verse hit me. Wow, the wind, the storm did not cease until he got in the boat. And I thought, wow, that's amazing. You know, it made me think storms. Just because Jesus rescues you from a storm doesn't mean he's going to actually relieve you of that storm immediately, because he actually has a plan through that storm. So the beauty of the story to me now is not about Peter walking on the water. The beauty of the story is what happened when they got back on the boat. So remember, the disciples are still there, okay? Because if it was me, I would have been thinking, where's Peter? He sunk. Jesus didn't call him out there. Now he's drowned. He's dead. I can't see anything. You know, I would have been thinking that. So keep that in mind. The disciples are still on this boat. And when Jesus gets back to the boat with Peter in hand, the Bible says, then they that were on the boat worshiped and said, truly, this is the Son of God. So the beauty of the story had nothing to do with Peter walking on the water. It was the fact that Jesus was showing them who he really was through their fear. And that blew my mind, because he was replacing their worry and their fear with faith. He was replacing it with confidence in Christ. And so I think that I want to encourage you guys today that if you're going through a storm today, remember, your storm is not about your fear. It's not about whatever that storm is. But God wants you to know, do not fear. Do not be afraid. There is hope in me. There is trust in me. I may be walking you through it, and maybe whatever you're going through, but I want you to see that you have to replace your worry and your fear with Jesus, because he is your shelter. He is your safety and your protection in the storm. Amen.
bless your name, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. You are our peace. Oh, the glory of your presence. We are temple. Give you reverence. So arise to your rest and be blessed by our praise as we glory in your embrace. As your presence. As your presence. Now fills this place.
Now fills this place.
If you know it, would you sing it with us? Oh, the glory. Of your presence. Temple. Oh, say one more time, so arise to your rest. Sing it, so. Amazing message, Kimberly. I never heard it from that perspective. Give my sister a great round of applause. I'm going to use that the next time I talk about Peter in the boat. Hope you got it copyrighted, because I'm going to say I made it up. What a privilege it is to be here in Cleveland. I was in Cleveland many years ago. I recorded years ago with the campus choir at Lee University. Oh, we got some. That was a lot of years ago. And what a privilege to be here at Westmore and to worship God with you. But before that even happened, many years ago, when I was a messed up Christian, walked away from God. He never walked away from me. But I walked away from God, got tired of church. I didn't like predominantly black churches because they were way too emotional. I didn't like predominantly white churches, they were way too dead. I was an equal opportunity hater. My sister told me about this church in downtown Brooklyn. I don't live right in Brooklyn anymore. I cannot live in a city like Brooklyn that does not have a Cracker Barrel. I can't. But my sister told me about this church, and I go to this church. I finally go after her consistent urging. And I walk into this church. This was, 1980 or thereabouts, and there were people of all different backgrounds worshiping God. There was black, white, Hispanic, Asian people. I had never seen that. I grew up in a black Baptist church that turned Pentecostal. We went from being dead to throwing the babies up in the balcony and swinging from the chandeliers. And now I walk into this church that was so different than how I grew up. The songs were different, the style, everything was different. But there was one thing I could not deny. Through the preaching, through the singing, I sensed the awesome presence of God. And it transformed this man's life. And to think that here we are all these years later, here we are, a bunch of New York City folk, standing, singing to all you Cracker Barrel folk. We want to be like you. But more importantly, who cares about black church and white church? Who cares about denomination? You know what's important? That we're washed in the blood of the Lamb. That's what's important. And so from those years ago, when my faith was weak, through every storm, I even had questioned God. Through those times when I felt like God was a million miles away, and I even thought that God had failed me. I've lived long enough, been through enough stuff, been encouraged by Pastor Cymbala and others who have spoken into my heart and life when they didn't even know they were speaking into my life. And now I can say that I'm a transformed man. I'm not what I want to be, but I'm not what I used to be. I've been changed. I've been transformed by the power of God. Can I get a witness in here of anybody else who's experienced that? Oh my God. The Bible says, forgetting those things which are behind, looking for those things which are before. So tonight we say,
I've been changed.
I've been changed. Rockefeller said, I won't go back.
Can't go back to the way it used to be before your presence came and changed me.
Sing it again, say.
Let's put our hands together one more time. Amen. Thank you, singers. You may be seated. They're coming back, and with the choir, they're going to sing a song that's going to make you just, well, we've already shouted for glory, but we're going to make you shout again. But let's just, I want to leave you with a verse and a thought today. Amen. We honor God's word here for a few moments, then they'll come back. It's, again, a joy to be with you. So a lot of years ago, I grew up in an alcoholic home. My dad was a drunk alcoholic, and he started drinking when I was about 12 years old. And so I grew up in a real hellish home. I couldn't have people come to my house because my dad would get totally out of control. He would beat on my mother, beat on us, and I was too small to hold him off her, and then I grew older. I could protect her some. So I turned to sports. I was athletic, and I really gave myself over to basketball and became an all-city player and ended up playing in college on a scholarship and playing in the NCAA tournament, the March Madness and all that. I was a point guard. And that was my life. I didn't go to Bible school, didn't go to seminary. My wife was a pastor's daughter, and she grew up with this musical gift, great keyboard player. Can't read or write music. Still can't read or write music. She's won 6 Grammy Awards. She still can't read or write music. So the joke in our church is she doesn't know what she's doing. She just keeps doing it every Sunday, and we're happy. So God put us together, and an unlikely couple to ever be in the ministry. That was the last thought that I ever had, be in the ministry. I knew how to shake and bake you, but I didn't know how to preach a sermon. And through a long story, which I won't go into, we ended up being called into the ministry. So here was someone, she was, you know, I was pastoring in a rundown building in downtown Brooklyn, and less than 20 people on Sunday morning. The first offering I took was $85, was the total tithes and offering. That's a very liberal word, tithes and offerings, $85. But it is what it is, and it was what it was. And we're downtown, no crack then, but there was a lot of heroin, a lot of gangs, a lot of just messed up people, alcohol, gangs, homeless. It's worse now, very much worse now, in downtown Brooklyn, where the church is. But here we were in this rundown building. It was so depressing, I didn't want to go, and I was in charge, which is not a good sign when you don't want to go to your own church. My sermons were so bad, people were converting to other religions while I was preaching. When you get through and they have a little red mark in their forehead, that was not a good sermon. That didn't work out. But that's the truth. But that's where God put us. So there was no money. When you have offerings of $85, there's no money. The building was run down, but that's where God put us. And you know, in the early church, they had no public buildings for 300 years. The Christian church didn't know public buildings, what we're used to. They had no Bibles in the New Testament time, hadn't been written yet, and yet they turned cities like Philippi upside down. Am I correct? They didn't have microphones. They didn't have a great band like orchestra you have, great choir like you all have here. They had, what did they have? They had God. They had the message of the gospel, the message of Christ. But they had this invisible thing called the blessing of God. There's a verse in Acts where it says, certain men from Cyprus and Cyrene went to Antioch and preached the gospel, and the hand of the Lord was with them, and multitudes turned to the Lord. You know, that's the hardest thing in the world, is to make a convert. Not rob people from other churches and not have good meetings and shout glory and run the aisles. That all has its place. But the hardest thing today, and the church is shrinking in America, shrinking very, very significantly. You can't do faith talk. You have to face reality or God won't help you. God can't help you if you're hyping things. It is what it is, but God can change it. How many believe God can change it? Come on, lift your hand. So here we were in a perfect mission field, people of every background, race. And here was my wife, very, very, at that time, very, very, very shy. She was very shy. And me, you know, just my sermons, I fell asleep while I was preaching, not just the people. It was a Sabbath. I thought we'd take a rest together, right? So I realized through my searching and reading and studying, I realized I grew up in church, I was pulled to church, and I felt and experienced real things, and then there were a lot of hyped up things, which weren't real. And there was not that many converts being made and being baptized in water. And, you know, just folks shifting from one church to another. And so I couldn't do that. Who would be attracted to come to our church? So I began a search, which I'm still searching today. God, what is the secret of having your blessing? Not the millennial type churches now where they don't preach the gospel, don't mention sin because you don't want to rattle anyone's cage and you don't want people to be like, yo, I didn't come here to be confronted about my lifestyle. You know, the rule in most places now is how do you get them back next week? But that has nothing to do with Christianity. We're not supposed to get them back next week. We've got to get them to Christ. We've got to get them into old things have passed away. Amen? Come on, let's shout to that. So we couldn't do that. We couldn't use marketing techniques, and we had no target group. That's a blasphemous term, to have a target group. If you're, imagine, Christ died for someone, but you don't want them to come to your church. They're not part of your target group. You really got to check yourself. You really need to check yourself. So whether they're black or white, young or old, poor, gay, straight, homeless, smelling, whatever, if Christ died for them, I want them to feel God's love. How many are with me? Say amen. Amen. So there's no new way of doing church. There's God's way of doing church. It's found in this book. So I'm searching always for like the hand of the Lord. That speaks of power. That speaks of miracles. That speaks of changed lives. That speaks about God transcending my weakness. I'm just speaking conversationally. That's all I can do. I'm not an orator. I'm not a preacher and type. And I don't want to be that because God only uses you when you're natural. The moment you put on anything, listen to me, pastors that are here. The minute you put on any voice or posture or change, the Holy Spirit backs away because he's the Spirit of truth. He didn't come to bless acting. If you want to go to Broadway, you can see great acting. But in church, we're supposed to be real. Because folks, listen, time out. I don't have that long, so don't keep interrupting me. No, but people are messing up with fentanyl and smoking weed all day long. Downtown Brooklyn, the weed is amazing. The smell of it is everywhere. Terrible. And people just, you know, meet with women, their daughters are cutting themselves or pulling out clumps of hair, and we're having church. I mean, I'm all for having church, but I mean, we got to see God change these people. Amen? Amen? The angels don't rejoice when your attendance numbers go up. The angels rejoice, wait, the angels rejoice when one sinner repents. How many want to see it? Come on, put your hands together. So, this story has meant so much to me. If you're longing for a miracle, I mean a divine intervention, not hyped up emotions, you know, not getting stirred but never changed. If we're looking for the miraculous power of the living Christ in our lives and in our ministries, the blessing of God upon us. You know, the blessing of God is a very invisible, incredible thing, you know. It just rests on certain churches and people, and I've wanted that more than anything in my life. I don't want the church to be about the pastor. I'm tired of that, like superstar pastors. Like, give it a rest. The only superstar in Christianity is Jesus Christ. He's the only superstar. So when pastors play to themselves and try to draw attention and act like they're somebody, it means they don't know God. They haven't ever met Jesus. Because when you meet Jesus, you go down low. Am I right or right? Am I right or wrong? You go down low. So the minute anyone's fronting and acting and putting on dramatic stuff, it's just going to pass and it'll come to nothing. But this story tells us how to see something continually in our lives. Just listen to it. You know the story. I'm going to read it quickly. I'm not going to talk for long. On the third day, a wedding feast took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no more wine." "Dear woman, why do you involve me?" That's a very difficult passage in the Greek. The commentators are not in agreement what exactly the Lord was meaning when he said, "Dear woman, why do you involve me?" Jesus replied, "My time has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby stood 6 stone water jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. We're talking about big jars for water. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom and said, "Everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink, but you have saved the best till now." This, the first of his miraculous signs, first miracle, Jesus performed in Cana in Galilee at a wedding. He thus revealed his glory, and his disciples put their faith in him. So that was a significant moment. At the very beginning of his ministry, that's John 2, in case you want to read it, it is Jesus going to a wedding, changing the water into wine, and at that moment, the disciples, early on there, they really trusted now and leaned on him and knew this is no ordinary rabbi or teacher. This was his first miracle, and this was a convincing miracle to them. All of his miracles were attesting signs to who he was, the Son of God. But this one is very significant. So I just want to leave you with this, that we can learn from this story something about the miraculous in our lives, the blessing of God. The water into wine is the natural into supernatural. The water into wine is my puny efforts replaced by Jesus' touch and the power of God and the blessing of God. So how did it happen? Let's just analyze it, and then they'll come back and we'll do something. We'll sing, we'll pray, we'll do something. You know, it's important that we pray, because God says, "My house shall be called a house of prayer." Not singing, not teaching, not preaching. I'm trying to do that now, but that's not what God's house is supposed to be called. It's supposed to be called a house of prayer. Why? Not like when I grew up, you gotta pray, Jim. No, it's God saying, please come to me. I have stuff that you can't believe that will enhance your life, strengthen you, help you, but come to me. Don't end up having it said about you, you have not because you ask not. That can't happen. So we're gonna pray here. So how did this miracle happen? He changed the water into wine in Cana of Galilee. How did it happen? Well, it happened first this way. Jesus was there. If he wasn't at the wedding, the water wouldn't have been turned into wine, correct? Why was he there? Because they invited him. So the first lesson to see the power of God, the blessing of God, the supernatural in our lives is invite Jesus into everything you're going to do every day of your life. Invite him. Mary was invited, and then John goes to point out, but Jesus and his disciples were also invited. If he hadn't been invited, he wouldn't go. He doesn't crash parties. He doesn't go in where he's not asked to. He doesn't come into your situations. You can pastor a church and never invite Jesus and his touch into it. You can do church by the numbers, do church by analytics and all the rest of that, marketing techniques. Or you can invite Jesus in and say, Jesus, you show yourself strong and mighty. I'm inviting you into that. Or every day of our life. How can we start a day? We got to ask Jesus into our life every day. How many have found you need him every day of your life? Lift up your hand. But he won't come and do what he wants to do unless you invite him. They send an invitation. Jesus, you and your disciples, please come to the wedding. I'll be there. Give me the place and the time. I'll be there. We need to invite him in every relationship, every decision you make. You can't leave your job unless you ask Jesus about it. Troublesome children, wayward children, you got to go to Jesus, invite them. In a relationship, single people planning on getting married and dating and maybe falling in love, you got to invite Jesus into the relationship. Wherever he's invited, he will come. And whenever he comes, something good is going to happen. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
So the way the miracle happened was Jesus was invited. If he wasn't invited, he wouldn't have come. If he wouldn't have come, no water into wine. They would have run out and nothing would have changed. That's how critical. How do you get saved? How do you become a Christian? You ask Jesus into your life. You don't join a church. You invite Christ into your life. You have a relationship with him. So that's number one. Number two, they ran out of wine. And Mary came to him, his mother, and said, they have no more wine. They have no more wine. Five words. If Mary wouldn't have come to him and told him the problem, Jesus would have never reacted to the problem because he needs to know what the problem is so then he can then go to work on it. That sounds simple, but it's not so simple. Mary came to him and told him the problem. How many times do we carry problems and burdens? And we call Aunt Florence or we talk to friends or we go on social media and we're complaining and we're having a pity party and we're talking to people, you don't know what I'm going through. And we never stop and go to Jesus and simply say, Jesus, here is my problem. His ear is always open to our cry. He never turns one person away. How many times in my own life I found myself, especially in years gone by, running around like a chicken without his head and floundering and what am I going to do? Instead of just coming to Christ, you have not because you ask not. Tell Jesus what you need tonight. You have a wayward child? Don't go into denial. Tell Jesus, I have a wayward child. This child is not serving the Lord. This child's soul is in jeopardy. I'm telling you, Lord, I need help. You don't think he'll help you? He died for you. Why wouldn't he help you? Why wouldn't he help me? Of course he would. He loves us. But you got to tell him the problem. And you don't have to use King James language. And you don't have to get all religious or Pentecostal about it or anything. Just talk to him. Just tell Jesus what the problem is. If they hadn't told him the problem, then the miracle wouldn't have happened. So he's telling us today, cut to the chase. Tell him what the problem is. Don't maneuver around it. Don't try to fix it yourself. You can't. We can't fix it. Years ago, I was going to Argentina, where I've been about 30 times in my life doing ministry. And we were just moving into this theater. It was the largest theater in North America when it was built. It's in downtown Brooklyn. Very historic theater. Was built in 1918, right at the end of World War, 1918, right at the end of World War I. And we had been meeting in different places and gone to a theater, and God kept saving souls, bringing people in, and now we need larger quarters. In fact, we were in a nice theater that seated about 1,200, 1,300 people, and we were there for a number of years, but we couldn't, that's where I met Alvin, but the people couldn't fit in, and we went to two services, three services, and then the pastors and I, we agreed, we prayed, we got to find a bigger facility, but that's hard in downtown Brooklyn. You all here, I just heard how many acres this church has. You got like 30, 40 acres here. I hate you all. I do. I really hate you. I've been looking for 30 feet my whole life just to, because in downtown Brooklyn, there's no space. You can't make space. So you can't build. No church buys property. Am I right, Alvin? No church buys a big lot and says, let's throw up a building. No one does that. Too expensive. So we found this building right before 9/11. This theater run down because Brooklyn had gone sideways, and now nobody was coming to downtown Brooklyn. At this time, this is right around 2001, and we purchased the building, and now we didn't know what we were getting into. It seated 4,100 originally, and now we, with different codes and sound boards and whatnot, it feeds like 3,500 people go in there. And it's great because it's located in downtown Brooklyn. Most of the people that come to our church don't have cars, so they have subways and buses that'll get there. And you ought to come and visit us. This fresh air is going to kill you, I'm telling you. This, come in graffiti, smog, dirt, rodents. We'll get you mugged if you'd like a special tour. But anyway. So during that process, I was heading to Argentina, and the work was going on. In fact, at 9/11, we lost four people more than any church in New York at that day, that tragedy. That infamous cloud came across the East River and went right on the facade of the building that we were fixing up, three office buildings and this ginormous theater. So they tell me before I go on this trip, an organization, Christian organization, that lent us millions of dollars to get it done, because we're doing this by faith. We're just on a shoestring. You know, I'm all for budgeting, but if you have no money, how do you budget? I always hear people say, you got to learn to budget. I'm down for that, but if you have no money, what do you budget? And yet God can provide as you go. That's how he did the Israelites. Every morning they had the manna they needed. So anyway, I go to Argentina, and this guy had called me before I left. You know, you're short $6 million. I said, what are you talking about? He said, no, you're short $6 million. You need $6 million to finish phase one, or you can't open in that building. I said, how did that happen? Our people were looking into this, the architects, everybody looked at it, you studied it. He said, listen, friend, I don't know, but you need $6 million. So I go to Argentina, spending more money, trying to bless pastors there. On my way back, before I went back, Carol and I were in a city called Mar del Plata, and I went out for a long, hours-long walk, and I needed to talk to the Lord. God, what am I going back to? How would I possibly get $6 million? No, I mean, be real. How would I get that? The people in our church don't have $6 million. They live mostly hand-to-mouth, most of them. We have some wealthier people. So God, what am I going to do? Who do I know that has a lot of money? I don't know anyone who has a lot of money. Maybe I'm a failure and I should be better at raising funds. Why am I in Argentina spending more of the church's money to reach pastors when we're short $6 million? So I pour my heart out to God and I just tell God the real deal. Like, God, you led us to do this. We fasted, we prayed before we made this decision. We need $6 million. And you know, there is a point of praying through, of holding it before the Lord, and then he gives you that peace that you know, I got your back. Praise God, I've got your back. I go back after 10 days to New York. I go to the office the next morning. They have emails and phone messages. Oh, the office, my desk was piled with stuff. At 12 noon, I get a letter from a man in Chicago who I had met once. He visited the church, businessman. I wouldn't have known him if he walked in. And in his note, he says to me, the Lord laid on my heart, your wife recorded a song. Your wife recorded a song, and I listened to that song, and God spoke to me through this song. And it stopped me from making a decision that would have lost all the money of my family, which was considerable. I was ready to make a bad investment. And I just want you to know that God put on my heart, I'm giving you $1 million. So I went, oh, praise God, I read it. I went to the finance department. We were high-fiving, doing the bump, everything. We were celebrating. And wow, $1 million from a man we don't know. I came back as God is listening to me. I came back to my office 10 minutes later. I opened another envelope, and it's from a woman who I still have not yet met. She's reclusive. She wishes not to be mentioned and all that. I've never met her now, but she wrote me and said, I understand you're in a program and whatnot. I don't know what you need or anything, but our foundation has decided to give you $5 million. So now listen, wait. I'm not good on math, but uno y cinco igual seis. 1 plus 5. Is not God amazing? None of these people knew. They knew nothing. They were just doing what God prompted them. When you and I ask the Lord, when we tell him what we need, we're going to see something wonderful happen. So let me close. Then the miracle goes on. It wouldn't happen if he wasn't invited. It wouldn't happen if they didn't tell him the need. Number 3, Mary comes to him and says, they have no more wine. And then she says this classic sentence, which many people don't know, one of the great sentences out of Mary's mouth. We don't know that much about Mary from the Bible. But she says to the servants, do whatever he tells you. Do whatever he tells you. That was a key to the miracle. Do whatever he tells you. Not only invite him, not only tell him what you need, but now stand ready to do whatever he tells you. You want to see the blessing of God on your life? Do we want to see prayers answered for our wayward children? Do we want to see God do beyond what we could ask or think even? Okay, we got to do whatever he tells us. How will he do what we ask if we don't do what he asks? There's a disconnect with a lot of people, especially the charismatic movement. They think you can live any way you want, sleep with whoever you want, carry on any way you want, and then just hit a button and God is a MasterCard who's going to pay what you need. It's not true. The Bible says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. How impossible would that be, me living in disobedience, not doing what God told me in his word, like love one another. Stop hating people of another race. Don't be a racist. Stop with this cultural fighting and wars and Fox News and CNN and all this nasty social media stuff where you attack other people. You're going to do that and have God be gracious and pour out what he wants to? No way. No way. You're reading the wrong Bible. Do whatever he tells you. If he's dealt with you about something you should stop doing, stop watching, stop talking about, you do that. See if he won't open the windows of heaven. We're not earning it. Don't mistake me. I'm not a legalist. We're not earning the answer, but you got to be on the same page with Jesus. You got to do whatever he tells you. Stop doing certain things. Maybe pay tithes like you told God 5 years ago. I got to start being more regular in my giving. Do it. He put that in your heart. Now do it. Don't talk about it. Do it. All the great men and women in church history who have been blessed by God and got prayers answered were people who walked close to Jesus. They were sensitive to anything he told them to do. And sometimes what he tells us to do is strange. Some are obvious things, but others are strange, like they're running out of wine and he tells the servants, fill that with water. Excuse me, sir, we don't need water. We got plenty of water. No, fill it with water. Hasn't the Lord ever done that with you? He leads us and he asks us to do something that doesn't quite make logical sense, but he knows exactly what he's doing. When he called, when I felt called into the ministry, resigned my job, I called my mother who was under siege. My dad was still drinking. And I said to my mom, here, I have a college degree and all that, working for an airline, traveling around the country for free, basically. Mom, Carol and I are going to go in the ministry. We're going to go to downtown Brooklyn and take over this church. She was heartbroken. What? How are you going to live? You already have, we had a baby at that time. And how are you going to live? And I said, well, we're going to live by faith. And my mother, being Polish, Eastern European, very practical, she said, and what does faith pay? That hurt me. I remember tears coming out of my eyes. But it's what God told us to do. I know, but how's it going to work out? I don't know how it's going to work out, but God's leading us to do it. If God's leading you to do something today, don't try to figure out. Do what he tells you. Go to that person. Apologize. Go on that mission trip. Start working with children. Whatever it is that God tells you to do, how in the world are we going to have an open heaven with God answering us if we're not obedient to what he tells us to do? Some of you are kind of resisting this, but listen, hear the word of the Lord. Obedience is better than sacrifice. To obey God is better than lifting your hands and rocking back and forth. I'm all for lifting our hands and rocking back and forth, but you can't play God. You can't con God. How are you going to con God? If I'm living a double life, how am I going to get away with that? I'm going to get up and preach and ask God for an anointing when he knows what I'm really about? Impossible. That's impossible. Do whatever he tells you. Because when our ear is open to him, his ear is going to be wide open to us. So finally, we learn, how do you have that blessing? You invite him into everything. How do you have that miracle happen? You tell him exactly what you need. Then you have to go into a posture of do whatever he tells you. Otherwise, you get self-centered. That's a lot of American Christianity. It's not what we do for the Lord. It's just gimme, 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 gimme. And the more we get, gimme, gimme. And you don't know what I'm going through. Relax. You're not going through something compared to other people. So finally, they brought the water to the man, to the master of ceremonies, and he tasted it, the water that had turned into wine, and he went, dude, this is heavy-duty wine. I mean, where in the world you get this stuff? He did not know it had been water turned to wine. And he went to the bridegroom and he said, you know, this is funny, party. What a reception you have. Most people give the good wine at the beginning and then the cheap stuff comes at the end. But you saved the best for last. I don't care how old you are. Listen to me. Look at me. I don't care how old you are. I don't care what you've done, not done. You turn to the Lord and we begin to trust him in a new way. The best is yet to come. I don't care what God, has done in this church. I don't care. The blessings of God are on this church. Obviously, you can't even imagine what God wants to do. The best is always yet to come. There's no trajectory in the Bible where God says, I'm going to lift you higher and higher. And then you're going to go down into a valley. No, that's not found. The Bible says, I'll bring you from glory to glory, from faith to more faith, from blessing to more blessing. So let's invite him. Let's tell him what we need. Let's be open to do whatever he tells us. And I'm telling you, in the name of the Lord, the best is yet to come. Could you bow your heads? Jamal, if you come, singers. If you're here, well, let's start with just, I heard those amens when I said that sentence. If you got a wayward son or daughter or a wayward grandchild, would you just stand up right now? So we're going to tell the Lord to recover stolen property. Come on, if you have a wayward child, just stand up. Nothing to be embarrassed about. If you're here tonight and you need a divine intervention in your life, spiritually, emotionally, mentally, financially, in some situation that you and God know about, like, Pastor, I need water turned into wine. I don't need a little help around the edges. I need big time divine help. I need it, and I see tonight that if I invite him into my life in a new, deeper way, if I yield myself to do whatever he tells me, if I tell him exactly what I need, the best is yet to come. He will glorify his name. We're going to start to sing this song that comes from Scripture, Psalm 23. As we begin, even before we begin to sing it, if you're standing, just make your way up here. Come on, come on. Get out of your seat. Come up here. Stand in the front, in the aisles. Come on. Vamanos, come on. Right to the edge. Come on. Come right up to the front. I think you know this song. Sing it with us.
Surely good.
Across.
Right beside me, oh, my bed, and I will dwell in your house forever.
thank you, Lord, that tears are a language you understand. Bring those daughters back. They're dedicated to you. Bring those sons back, Lord. Nothing's too hard for you. They're in darkness, so shine your light on them, Lord. They believe lies, so send your truth. We don't care where they are, making a lot of money or in prison. Rescue them, Lord. Recover stolen property. Satan, the blood of Jesus is against you. You know the other needs that are here, Lord. Didn't you say your house would be called a house of prayer? When they try to make it someplace else to make a buck, you cast the money changers out of there. My house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations. And we're here today. Now do what you promised. You said, call in the day of trouble and I will answer you. We're in a day of trouble and we're calling. Will you not answer us? No, we believe your word. Let every man be a liar, but your word is true. Let miracles begin right this moment. Send angels on assignment right now. Move them out, Lord. Move them out. Get to where they need to go, Lord. Our finances, our families, our ministries. Some discouraged minister of music, some discouraged pastor. Someone who's taken the wrong road. They're going down a rabbit trail, Lord. Get him back. Get him back in the name of Jesus. Doing your work, your way, for your glory.
Surely goodness, surely mercy,
Mariano Bocosati, sing everyone. Believe God's promise. Let's put our hands together real loud. Everyone who believes God's promise. We believe, therefore we speak, and we clap, and we praise, and we worship. Change the water into wine. Natural to supernatural. Let the blessing of God rest upon this conference, upon these people. When they end up going home tonight, give traveling mercies, but the best is yet to come. Give the folks involved in church this coming Sunday the best Sunday they've ever had. The best Sunday they've ever had. Why not? It's not hard for you, Lord. Should we believe for less? No, we believe for more, Lord. We ask it in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. So nice being with you. So we're going to do one last thing before a pastor comes here to give you a last word. Stay right where you are. This is a song they're going to sing with the choir. And I want you to clap. And if you'd like, move exactly with the group, okay? However they move, you will move. Do I have your word? I said, do I have your word? Are you ready? Okay. We're going to go out. Then someone will come back to give the final word. But we're going to go out with this song, okay? Listen. Listen.